Okay, so this is one of my Ottoman playthroughs. As you can see, my empire stretches from Eastern Europe, from over here, all the way over to the borders of India in the east. I like that. Anyways, I've got a slight problem with some Russians here. There's a funny story there. You remember me telling you a while back how you should always check the alliances that people are in before you wage war on them? Well, yeah, I declared war on Bohemia, and they're allied with Russia, and well, there's Russia. And there's Russia. That didn't go so well, but I can probably still claw this back. Anyway, moving swiftly on, let's discuss technology. So if we go into the technology tab, you can see here that this is my military technology level. I'm currently at level 26, with my next level being, of course, 27, for those of you who have any difficulty counting. I'm assuming that as you're watching a tutorial for a Paradox Interactive game, that won't be many of you. Each tech level, you get something. These icons here show you what you'll get. So in this case, I will unlock a new unit, the Royal Mortar. I will increase my supplier limit, and my infantry fire increases by 0.5. So what the hell does all that mean? Well, here we get a nice, neat summary of our current tech level and capabilities. This is Maneuver. Maneuver has two functions. The first is that it allows you to increase the speed at which you can maneuver your units around the map. The second is that it increases the combat range of your units. When your units are lined up in a row against the enemy's units, a unit with a high maneuver is able to strike out at enemies a much greater distance away. This essentially means that multiple units can gang up on one unit, whereas at lower levels, that's much harder. Next up is Land Morale. Morale is very important as it's a measure of your unit's staying power. A unit with high morale can soak up a lot of damage and stand and fight. This means that if you have a unit with lesser numbers and lesser tech, but a much higher morale than the enemy, that unit can still win, because while it's soaking up a lot of damage, it's still going to stand and fight, and every time it fights back, the enemy loses morale. And if they lose all their morale first, even if there's a larger number of them, even if they have better tech, they'll break and run, and you win the fight. Although the losses may mean that you might have rather have lost the fight. Next up is the supply limit. Every province has a supply limit. That can be modified by the construction of different buildings and the province itself. It's basically a measure of how many regiments you can cram into that province before they'll start suffering attrition. Attrition is a percentage loss on your units. The further you are over the supply limit, the more attrition your units will suffer. Attrition is basically killed soldiers. They're not necessarily killed, some of them may desert, but the end result is the same. Your military is reduced in its numbers, and those men need to be replaced from your manpower pool. This means that with clever use of this attrition mechanic, you can actually seriously damage an opponent's army without ever even needing to wage a single battle. Next up is your military tactics. Military tactics is basically a measure, one of the many measures of your army's ability to tank. Higher military tactics reduces the amount of damage that you receive. Combat width. This is very important. There is a limit in Europa Universalis IV as to how many troops you can bring to bear at any one time. So, for example, if your combat width is 10, then you can only put 10 units into the front line of the fight. Your remaining units will basically linger at the back, plugging gaps in the line as necessary. This means it is advantageous to have more units than your combat width. However, if you have a greater combat width than the enemy, it increases the likelihood of multiple units attacking one enemy unit and therefore breaking the enemy army much more quickly. And finally, these are all the buildings that you've unlocked. These buildings have different effects. Some of them will reduce maintenance costs and recruitment costs for your units. Some of them will make provinces harder to siege, and some of them will improve your manpower. Some of them will do more than one. So that basically means that at the next tech level, I will gain a new unit, the Royal Mortar, and you can see here that this is also indicated by the fact my current unit, the Cohorn Mortar, is highlighted. My supply limit will go up. That means that I'll be able to fit more troops into a single province without losing them to attrition, and my infantry's fire value will go up. So what does that mean? Well, we can see the two main statistics for our units here. Fire is a measure of your unit's ability to inflict damage with their muskets and various other firearms. Shock is their ability to do damage in the melee. At this period in history, guns still weren't the main thing that won battles. Muskets, cannons and so on were typically used to whittle down enemy numbers, put holes in their formations and damage their morale, but victory would usually be achieved with a bayonet charge. Therefore, combat cycles between two different modes, fire and shock. Fire being the point where everyone's shooting at each other, and shock being infantry charges. Therefore, you can see that my infantry are fairly balanced. They have a score of 1.6 in fire and 1.65 in shock. My cavalry, on the other hand, have only 1 in fire but 4 in shock, and my Cohorn mortars have a mighty 6.4 in fire but only 0.45 in shock. So at the next level, my infantry gain a pretty significant boost to their fire, bringing them up to, if we check here, 2.1, pretty respectable. If you hover over the unit name, you can get a full idea of their current capabilities and a flavor text. Should be pointed out, these are current modifiers. If you hover over the name, you can see the base value there. Different units have different base values, and at certain tech level you'll have more than one unit to choose from. So for example, if we check my current military tab, you can see that I currently have a number of options available to me for infantry. Hang on, that's cavalry, including Frederican infantry, redcoat, bluecoat and whitecoat infantry, and these are their fire and shock values. For example, if we look at the Frederican infantry, we can see that they're quite evenly balanced. They have a defensive fire of 7 and an offensive fire of 8. This means that they're slightly better at dishing out damage than they are at taking it. Redcoat infantry, on the other hand, have a defensive score of 8 and an offensive score of 6. This means that they will soak up a lot more damage, however, they won't do quite as much as the Frederican infantry. And whitecoat infantry, you can see, are very balanced with offensive and defensive fire scores of 5. So why, for example, would we want redcoat infantry when they're only 8-6, whereas Frederican infantry are 7-8? They're just better. Well, the difference comes here in the shock phase. Redcoat infantry are very balanced at shock. Their offensive score is 6 and their defensive score is 6, whereas Frederican infantry have an offensive score of 5 and a defensive score at a measly 4. This means that while the Frederican infantry may do a lot more harm and take less harm in the fire phase, the redcoat infantry are better balanced overall. And if we check the final element, which is their morale, they have a mighty score of 10 in their morale, which is peerless amongst this current generation of infantry. Morale is a measure not only of your troops' ability to stand and fight as their friends get gunned down next to them, but also their ability to just scare the living shit out of the enemy. So for example, you can see that Frederican infantry have an offensive morale of 10, which is pretty damn high. This basically means that when Frederican infantry are involved, enemy units are a lot more likely to break and run. And in Europa Universalis IV, that is very important, because typically battle will be won by one side breaking and fleeing. Very rarely, unless there is an overwhelming difference in units and a lot of combat width difference involved, will an army be outright destroyed. So how do these scores actually work out in combat itself? Well, it's fairly straightforward. A dice is rolled and then your offensive score is added as a positive modifier, whereas the enemy's defensive score is added as a negative modifier. Other modifiers may also be used. And that's basically the damage you've done. That's then repeated in the other phase, alternating between fire and shock, with a sort of morale phase between each fire and shock phase. It's basically dice games, but you can modify those dice games with the various modifiers that are available to you, such as these pips, generals, and a variety of national modifiers, which we'll get to in a moment. So, let's take a look at this military tab in greater detail. You can see here the current units which are available to you. Clicking on one of these will take you to the screen that I just showed you, where you can select different unit types, should you so desire. And you can also see important statistics related to the units here. This is their recruitment cost. It should be noted that recruitment costs can be lowered by building certain buildings, and any building that lowers recruitment cost will also lower maintenance costs. Next up is a modifier to your unit's combat ability. These can come from a variety of sources, mostly ideas. For example, I have the Timariot system idea, which is a national idea for the Ottomans, which gives their cavalry combat plus 15%. Here in the quality ideas, I have a few different ideas which are assisting in a number of areas. So for example, infantry combat ability is plus 10%. I also get an extra plus 10% on my cavalry, and massed battery gives me 10% on my artillery combat. And you can see all of those are reflected in the military tab here. You can hover over these icons like you can in most elements in Paradox games to see what makes them up. Here you can see repeated from the technology screen the bonuses currently being applied to fire and shock for each of these unit types. And finally, there is the number of each regiment that I have. Below that is a measure of your current naval units, but we're not going to cover naval combat in this episode. Next up, over here, you have some useful national level information at a glance. First off is your army tradition. Army tradition can be gained by fighting and winning battles. It can also be gained through various ideas, and of course, as with most things in Paradox games, random events. The effects you can see here by hovering over it. Land morale, again, you can see the effects by hovering over your morale, but the higher your morale is, the less likely your army is to break. Force limit. Force limit is a limit on the number of regiments that you can actually have active at one time. Going over that will incur increased maintenance costs. So I'm having to pay an extra 3.78 gold per month, but even after accounting for that, I still have 46,000 gold in my treasury, and I'm gaining an extra 160.18 a month. It's good to be me. Next up, military tactics. As we've said before, military tactics reduces the amount of damage that your units take, and it has a national level which can be further modified by various other situational modifiers and unit types and bonuses. Discipline does for offense what military tactics does for defense. The higher your discipline, the more damage your units will do in combat. And finally, defensiveness. During sieges, which I'll show you one now as my provinces are under siege, you have a ticker. The higher your defensiveness score is, the longer this ticker takes to fill up. Each time this ticker fills, there's a dice roll. Whenever that dice is rolled, these modifiers are all added. When those modifiers are added, a table is looked up, and that's the table there. And whichever score you end up getting, that effect is applied. Each effect applied may increase the siege phase. This doesn't increase automatically every time this goes up. One of these effects has to be triggered. And the siege phase itself is also a modifier. This basically means that as the siege goes on, you're more likely to end up rolling higher numbers, and eventually you're going to get to that magic number, which is 20, which is when the siege ends and the defenders surrender. So defensiveness defends against that. By increasing the amount of time it takes for that ticker to fill up, you increase the length of time that your forts can hold out. Finally, leaders. Each leader that you have costs you one military power per month. By default, you can have one free leader. However, as you can see here, I can keep three. This is due to a variety of special buildings that I have constructed. This essentially means that I could have three military leaders without needing to pay any cost. However, as I have four, if I hover over my military power here, you can see that that inflicts a minus one penalty each month to my military power. The fact that your monarch points are so important that you need to use them to research technology, to construct certain buildings, and to achieve other effects means that anything that reduces the number of monarch points you're getting a month needs to be very carefully considered. Generals are, however, very useful. You can see they have a modifier associated with each phase in combat and with sieges, and a maneuver. Maneuver increases the speed that they can move their armies around the map. Siege adds a bonus to sieges, so whenever that dice is rolled, the bonus is applied equal to the general siege score. And every time a regiment makes a dice roll in the combat phases, these numbers are also added to that as well. This means that a general can seriously add an edge onto an army, and it's always a good idea to have one when going into combat. But that needs to be weighed up with the notion that if you have over your limit, shall we say, of generals, then you're going to be losing potential military power, and that means losing potential military tech. You can recruit various types of leaders down here, including generals, who lead your armies, admirals, who lead your fleets, conquistadors, who can be used to explore unexplored lands, and explorers, who are like conquistadors, but for ships. Finally, you can make a general out of your heir or out of your ruler. This is a double-edged sword. Whilst your ruler or heir won't consume military power, using them in battle means that they may very well get killed. On the other hand, this can be a good thing. You can check your current heir at the government tab, and if you're not happy with your heir's stats, you can quite happily ship him off into combat and just hope that he gets killed. This heir may well go that way. While his military score of 6 is really, really good, and his diplomacy score of 3 is adequate, that administrative score of 1 is seriously problematic. Okay, so we've looked at the high-level organization and at the technology. Now let's have a look at how you can actually organize your armies. First of all, the best way to construct new units is using this production interface tab here. Click once, click the unit you want, click the province you want to build them in, repeat as much as you like. This is incredibly useful. It basically means that you can assign a huge amount of production to a large variety of provinces in seconds. You can have an entire army queued up for construction in half a minute. You can then click the minus button to get rid of them if you so desire. Each province will also show you the recruitment time and the cost. Recruitment time and cost varies from province to province and is further modified by the buildings within that province. So for example, constructing, shall we say, a barracks, if I can find it, reduces the cost of recruiting regiments by 5%. That will also apply, as I said before, to their maintenance costs as well. So if you're having a large army and it's dragging down your economy, barracks may be a good investment. They require military power to build, but can not make you money, but save you money. So how much to build and what of? Well, that varies, but the best general idea is start with your combat width. The reason you start with your combat width is basically because cannons have a special ability. They can fire from the second rank. There are two ranks in combat, both equal to your combat width. So if your combat width is 25, you can actually field 50 units. However, anything that isn't a cannon and isn't in the first rank is basically just sitting there waiting to fill a hole that appears in the first rank. However, during the fire phase, cannons can fire on the enemy from that second rank, albeit at a 50% reduction to their power. But that basically means that if you've got any less than your combat width's worth of cannons, you're kind of wasting potential firepower. So you would start with, in my case, 25 cannons. If your combat width was, for example, 10, you'd start with 10 cannon. You would then want to make up that number again out of infantry and cavalry. These would essentially provide your front line and provide defense for your cannons. You then want to throw in a few more infantry and possibly a few more cavalry, and then, if you can, a few more cannons. This basically means that you can then replace any casualties. If your combat width was 25, as mine is, and you field only 50 units, this means that as soon as a regiment has gone down, you're no longer fighting at your maximum potential. As an example, I'm going to show you one of my armies here. Let's see if we can find one that hasn't been mauled in the current conflict. This is the Army of Anatolia. This is a slightly older variation of one of my armies, but unfortunately my current army formation is this one, and, well, as you can see, it's getting quite badly mauled over here. So the Army of Anatolia is the example we'll use. Previously, I only had a combat width of 19. This basically meant that I only bothered fielding 19 regiments of cannon at any one time. I then made out the rest of the numbers with infantry and cavalry. In order to stop you building nothing but cavalry, because, well, cavalry are better at shock and cannon are better at fire, so why bother with infantry at all? Well, you have the insufficient support penalty. The amount of cavalry that you can have varies depending on your nation. For example, steppe nomads can have armies of nothing but cavalry, whereas most Western units can only have no more than 50% cavalry compared to infantry. This does not mean that you take your number of infantry, halve it, and that gives you the number of cavalry you can have. It basically means that you take your number of infantry, halve that number, add that number to your current unit of infantry, and that is how many cavalry you can have. It's an increase of 50% on the number of infantry you have, not 50% of that number. So in this case, 12, 6, 18, I could have potentially 18 units of cavalry. Generally speaking, it's a good idea to be close to that limit, but not too close. Close to the limit because cavalry are really good, but not too close because if you take losses on your infantry in combat and you end up reaching that threshold because of it, then the insufficient support penalty will still kick in. The insufficient support penalty gives you a penalty to your military tactics, which means that your units will start suffering greater damage. So, let's take a look at a combat in progress. Not one I'm particularly proud of, but let's take a look at this one here. You can click the combined icon here of the two units to see the fight in progress. Each side has the same lists modified, and it's useful to take a look at these because it can give you an idea of a nation's current combat abilities. For example, my discipline is higher than theirs, meaning I'm doing more damage. But my morale is higher than theirs, meaning that I'm more likely to stay in the fight. Which, when you look at these sorts of numbers and these sorts of differences, well, it's amazing they haven't broken already. Finally, my military tactics is lower, however I'm suffering a 25% penalty on that because casualties have reduced the number of infantry I have to far, far lower than the threshold when cavalry supply is considered. So, you've seen the composition of both sides, now let's have a look at the terrain. Terrain is important because it determines, amongst other factors, combat width. Essentially, if you're in something like, for example, mountainous terrain, combat width is much reduced. This essentially can give a huge advantage to a nation which has a lower combat width than the other nation, or an army that is smaller, because it essentially means that the combat will be drawn out for longer, increasing the chance of aid coming to the beleaguered army. You can see here that there are the two ranks. In the enemy's first rank, they have some bluecoat infantry here, and some Latin hussars, which are cavalry, here. These are not doing anything. They're just sitting there waiting for one of these regiments on the front line to fall. If one of those regiments fall, then one of these units will come up to replace it. However, these icons show cannon. Cannon can fire from the rear rank, as we covered, and you can see the units they are targeting here. Finally, in the front row, we have cavalry on the flanks. The AI will automatically populate the positioning of your units, always putting your cavalry on the flanks, and your infantry holding the middle. So, in this case, I'm pretty badly screwed, and the reason is that all of these units, well, they're attacking at once. So let's take a look at a combat that's slightly more in my favour, and take a look at the process from start to finish. I have here an army of Revolution Breakers. These are smaller armies that I use on autonomous rebel suppression. This basically means that they march around the nation whenever there's a rebellion and put it down for me. I have a second unit here as well called the Custodial Division. I'm not very good at naming my armies. We're not going to use one of those because neither of them are my standard composition. They don't really have enough cannons, and they don't really have a balance of infantry and cavalry, but the reason is they don't need it. They're just putting down peasants with pitchforks. On the other hand, we do need to do something about this army here. I'm currently laying siege to Bosnia with this army. Hopefully that will resolve soon. And these armies, well, they're in the best position to help. So let's issue a move order and get them moving over there. Let's check they both have generals. This one doesn't, but there's no general to assign. Let's find an army that isn't going to be engaged in combat and does have a general. That would be this one. I can click there and then click no leader. That removes the leader. And I can then attach him to this army. All this general does is a slight point in the shock phase of combat. That's all. Oh, and a maneuver node to make them move a bit faster. He's a very, very bad general, but a bad general is better than no general. If you don't use them, you lose them. Well, you don't lose them, but they're pretty much useless if they're not in combat. Okay, so we'll move these fellows up. We'll wait for this to break, and we'll hope the situation doesn't get any worse. Ah, another army over here. I'm going to move them in as well, just in case. There's a large Russian detachment up there, and the Russian army is both numerous and very high quality. As such, I generally don't like facing them unless I have an advantage of at least 2 or 3 to 1. Due to the length of this video, I've divided it into 2 parts. Theory and practice. You just finished watching theory. You now know enough to actually play the game and manipulate your military correctly. Practice is a bit of a let's play. I'm going to go through and fight that Russian invasion and also try and tie up things on the Western Front as well. This will give you a better idea as to how warfare actually plays out in reality, so it's worth watching if you still not feel entirely comfortable with how these ideas are applied. On the other hand, if you are, go and try them out in the game. For now, I'm UVST, signing off.